Hello everyone. We are passing on to the third toxicant as per your syllabus. So we were dealing with the toxicants and their adverse effects, isn't it? So here we are going to deal with, in this presentation, we will be dealing with the toxic metals or the heavy metals. Okay. So toxic metals, there are several metals and metalloids and even their compounds that are toxic and cause serious health hazards to man and other organisms and even affect the environment. They have been shown to cause acute and chronic poisoning to man as well as other animals. Apart from this, some of them are carcinogenic. For example, like arsenic, nickel, etc., they are carcinogenic to man and other animals. The toxicity in general, it is the toxicity of metals in general, it is due to the chemical reactivity of their ionic forms with enzymes, structural proteins, and membrane systems. The target sites of metals are usually the organs or tissues in which they can accumulate in high concentrations. For instance, it may be fatty tissues, it may be like what you call liver, etc. The major toxic metals of concern include aluminium, arsenic, cadmium, chromium, copper, lead, manganese, mercury, and zinc. So we will be dealing with each of these heavy metals, their role in the nature, as well as what happens when these heavy metals enter the organisms and how it is affecting the organisms as well as the environment. Okay, the first one is aluminium. Aluminium is the third most abundant metal on the Earth's crust, and it is extensively used for making household utensils, for canning and food packaging, and as aluminium foils for covering and preserving food and other articles. In the human body, bone and lungs have the highest concentration of aluminium. In blood plasma, 80 to 90% of aluminium remains bound to the iron transfer protein known as transferrin. Okay, iron in the what you call blood, it gets transferred with the help of a protein that is the transferrin. Okay, you'll be learning it in detail when you study the physiology. At higher concentrations, aluminium interferes with phosphate metabolism. It reduces phosphate metabolism. It is always related with the triphosphate, nuclear phosphates. Okay, the what you call nucleotide phosphates like ATP, ADP, etc. So it reduces the availability of ATP and casein, the milk protein, and inhibits some of the enzymes by complexing with them. It may also adversely affect the intestinal absorption of fluorides and the compounds of calcium and iron. So aluminium is, even though not seriously toxic to human beings, it still causes, inhalation of it causes pneumonia, may cause of pneumonia in some people. It binds with bone and causes osteomalacia in certain situations. In some organs, including brain, it may modify calcium metabolism. So I hope it is clear. Okay. Now next is arsenic. Arsenic is a deadly toxic metalloid. Its high toxicity is in its trivalent state, that is As3+. Then in human beings, it may get concentrated in blood, bone, teeth, intestinal wall, liver, kidneys, etc. Its target sites include skin, liver, lungs, kidneys, nervous system. And a mild dose of arsenic may cause slow poisoning, leading to nausea, profuse salivation, vomiting, fainting, burning pain in the stomach. But high doses may cause skin cancer, muscular weakness, damages to liver, kidneys, and nervous system. And fatal doses, it can result in death due to renal failure, vascular failure, shock, etc. In human beings, ingested arsenite may get oxidized to arsenate, which in turn gets reduced to arsenite again. Okay, that is arsenic. It enters the body as arsenite, but inside it gets oxidized to arsenate, and after absorption, it gets reduced to arsenite again. Okay, both these inorganic forms may be partly methylated to form monomethyl arsenic acid and dimethyl arsenic acid. And this methylation is supposed to be detoxification mechanism to check arsenic toxicity. That is, methylation can actually reduce the toxicity of arsenic. Okay, so I hope it is clear. So in different doses, it has like the effects keeps on becoming severe as the dose increases, and we can see that it actually affects the kidneys and the blood system, the circulatory system. Okay, the next one is cadmium. Cadmium is a toxic heavy metal. At higher levels of exposure, it is toxic to all the systems and functions of man and many other animals. Free metallic cadmium very rarely occurs in nature. Mostly it occurs in association with the ores of zinc, copper, and lead. Cadmium is used in several industrial processes such as electroplating, manufacture of pigments, paints, and plastics, in welding electrodes, etc. A copper cadmium alloy is used in automobile radiators. Occupational exposure to airborne cadmium fumes is hazardous to human beings. A major non-occupational source of cadmium is tobacco smoking. One cigarette contains almost 1 to 2 micrograms of cadmium. Nearly 10% of the cadmium enters the body during smoking. Cadmium pollution of the toxic aquatic environment is much more serious problem. Cadmium is not only highly toxic to organisms, but also its toxicity is cumulative. Cumulative means increases. Okay, increases. Okay, cadmium absorption is mostly respiratory, and to a lesser extent, elemental. Elemental in the sense it is absorbed along with it enters along with the foot of water and along with the elementary canal, the wall of the elementary canal, it may enter the blood. But more prominent is the absorption through the respiratory surface. In human beings, nearly 50 to 75% of the body burden of cadmium is in liver and kidneys. The more cadmium gets stored in liver and kidneys. Lung is the major target organ of inhaled cadmium, and kidneys are the major target organs of the ingested cadmium. So cadmium can enter, as we have already seen, it can enter the body along with the food or water, or it may even get into the body along with the inhaled air. And the inhaled cadmium, the major target organ is lung, while the ingested cadmium, it reaches the kidneys. Okay, so low levels of cadmium in the human body may cause profuse salivation, nausea, vomiting, severe bronchitis, emphysema, and pulmonary edema. So you can see it is all associated with lungs, especially the what you call inhaled cadmium. It could be acute cadmium poisoning may cause skeletal deformations, vomiting, abdominal cramps, and ultimate collapse. Chronic exposure. Acute exposure means a small the time span will be very less. Okay, but while chronic means it is a longer period of exposure to cadmium. It can cause pulmonary fibrosis, respiratory disorders, kidney damage, osteoporosis, liver dysfunction, anemia, and hypertension. Okay, so now next is chromium. Chromium is an abundant metal, extensively used in electroplating, manufacture of pigments and paints, etc. The chromium in hexavalent form is highly toxic and corrosive, and high levels of them may cause chronic ulceration and perforation of the nasal septum, nausea, vomiting, intravascular hemolysis. That is, hemolysis means blood breakdown, sorry, blood cell breakdown, sorry, and that can happen within the blood vessel itself. Hypertension, renal failure, it can result in coma and ultimately death. Okay, so it is a highly toxic metal. It is abundant in abundant, and so the what you call extent of its effect is more severe. Now next is copper. Copper is widely distributed. Next to iron and aluminium, copper is the third most important metal for human use. Environmental contamination with copper results mostly from its discharge from industrial plants, copper mining, metallurgical operations, etc. Copper is in nature, in organisms, copper is an essential constituent of several enzymes. That is, it is naturally a part of many enzymes. It is also essential for the utilization of iron. Iron deficiency anemia in infants is often accompanied by copper deficiency. And copper deficiency is characterized by hypochromic microcytic anemia. Hypochromic. That is, you know that blood, the red color is just because of hemoglobin, isn't it? And iron deficiency anemia is usually accompanied by copper deficiency. That is, copper deficiency can result is always associated with iron deficiency anemia. And iron is an important constituent of hemoglobin. So what happens is the amount of hemoglobin will be less, and as a result, the color of the normal color may not be attained. So that is hypochromic. Microcytic anemia, the RBC, the cells will be smaller sized. Okay, it results from defective hemoglobin synthesis, right? So copper deficiency is always characterized by hypochromic microcytic anemia. Here we are speaking about less amount of copper reaching the body. Inhalation of airborne copper causes irritation of the respiratory tract. Chronic exposure may cause lung cancer. So here we are speaking about the increased exposure of copper or exposure to increased amount of copper. Acute poisoning with ingested copper causes gastrointestinal disorders, hemolysis, hepatotoxic, that is, it is toxic to the liver, nephrotoxic effects, that is, it is toxic to the kidneys. Okay, so this is about the copper. Then next is you have the manganese. Manganese is an essential trace element. It is a cofactor of several enzymes. Yes, that is naturally, it is a part of the enzymes. The enzymes can, I hope you remember, you know, holoenzyme, isn't it? So holoenzyme, there are two parts. Yes, so one component in many of the enzymes, the holoenzyme can be formed only when there is manganese. Okay, and manganese is a cofactor for several enzymes. Manganese is extensively used in steel industry, in the manufacture of ferromanganese alloys, in dry cell batteries, etc. Burning of fossil fuels is the principal source of manganese in the environment. Manganese is present in all living systems and its major concentration is in mitochondria. Pancreas, liver, kidneys and intestine are the major storehouses of manganese in the human body. Manganese is toxic to nervous system. Manganese poisoning, which is referred as manganism, produces neuropsychiatric disorders characterized by irritability, difficulty in walking, disturbed speech, and compulsive behavior such as running, fighting, singing. Advanced stage of manganese poisoning may result in Parkinsonism and psychosis. That is, it is affecting the nervous system in a higher level. Okay. Next we have is lead. Lead is the most ancient industrial toxicant. It is widely used in printing, manufacture of paints, water pipes, battery, pottery, etc. Also, it is used as an anti-knock agent in gasoline. Okay, in that is the fuel we use in vehicles. And that is why lead is a component in automobile exhaust, which we have already seen, isn't it? Lead in the gasoline is a common environmental pollutant. And lead is toxic to nervous system, red bone marrow, and kidneys. Its major toxicological effects include interference with the heme synthesis. Heme is a part of the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is composed of heme as well as a protein component which is known as a globin. And heme, we can see it is composed of iron and the pyrrole ring. So that synthesis of the heme, it is interfered by the presence of lead in a high amount. Chronic exposure to lead causes vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain, damages to liver, kidney, nervous system, nervousness, delirium, convulsions, coma, and ultimate death. Apart from this, lead has a carcinogenic as well as teratogenic effects as well. I hope you remember what is carcinogenic and teratogenic effect. Okay. Now, next one is mercury. Mercury is a highly toxic metal. Anthropogenic sources of environmental mercury. What is anthropogenic sources? That means man-made sources. Okay. Include mining, smelting and manufacture of paper pulp, paints, batteries, lamps, etc. Now, mercury is toxic to renal, that is kidney, as well as the nervous system. Mercury poisoning is lethal and it may cause Minamata disease and ultimate death. Minamata disease is characterized by dysarthria, ataxia, and tremor. Dysarthria, the term says dysarthria, and arthria, it is referring to joints. Okay, dysarthria means weakness or incoordination of speech muscles. Okay, now ataxia means loss of coordination, okay, and tremor. So these are the features of it's all these happens because it is affecting the nervous system, right? And the last one is zinc. Zinc is a trace metal, nutritionally essential to organisms, that is, it is a part of normal functioning of several enzymes. And it is used in batteries, construction materials, pigments, and printing process. It is also used as a protective coating over iron, steel, brass, etc. Higher concentration of zinc in the human body may cause gastrointestinal disorders such as vomiting and diarrhea. In fishes, high levels of zinc decrease oxygen consumption, damage gills, retard growth and reproductive potential.